the?
Best.
Love the?
Best.
Guard our?
Freedom.
The next speaker generated quite a bit, hasn't he?
We know.
Broncos. Cancelled. A club known for its integrity and courage pulled the pin after they were got at. 50 academics trying to protect who knows what. Scared. And the media, have you had a look at those academics? The ABC keep parading advocates on the TV and the radio who have been guilty of misrepresenting the science. Just in the last week, I've had an ABC journalist call me wanting contact with some scientists, so I provided her with some names. All three of the scientists she has contacted have been disgusted. She was not interested in the science from what they could see, she was interested in muckraking. That was their opinion. That's your taxpayers' money. Control. Why do people control? Underneath control there is?
Money.
Fear. Why would you be afraid of a man who's done so much research? I'll tell you why you'd be afraid. He's got a long list of qualifications, a long list of proven successes. You can Google them and have a look. Listen to this though. He's respectful of others. I've watched him clean up someone absolutely in a debate in Brisbane. Entirely respectful, gracious in victory. He's knowledgeable on the science. He's knowledgeable on the maths. He's got experience in the bureaucracy, which is where the corruption started. He could see this scam, and he exposed it. He exposed the Copenhagen Draft Treaty, which shows provisions in there to rob us of our national sovereignty, our finances, control our energy, and listen to this, I've read it, control the allocation of resources and property. He is knowledgeable, insightful, incisive, masterful, and he's also entertaining. That got him into strife, but he apologized unreservedly for what one careless comment. I want to introduce to you a man very strong in character, very strong and knowledgeable. I welcome to Sydney Viscount Monckton of Brenchley.
Truth, one, forces of darkness, nil. Since we're in a football club, I thought I'd give you the results. My subject, very straightforward. ETS?
No!
Carbon tax?
No!
Mineral resources rent tax?
No!
What a wonderful audience. Well, that's the end of my speech. Imagine if the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change were asked to write Hamlet's great soliloquy. They would have done it something like this. To be or the contrary. Whether the former or the latter be preferable would seem to admit of some difference of opinion. The answer in the present case being of a negative or of a positive character, according as to whether one elects on the one hand mentally to endure the disfavor of fortune, albeit in extreme degree, or on the other, boldly to envisage adverse conditions in the prospect of eventually bringing them to a conclusion. The condition of sleep is similar to, if not indistinguishable from, that of death, and with the addition of finality, the former might be considered identical with the latter, so that in this connection it could be argued, with regard to sleep, that were the addition to be effected, a termination might be put to the endurance of a multiplicity of inconveniences, not to mention a number of downright evils incidental to our fallen humanity, and thus a consummation achieved of a most gratifying nature. But I'm going to speak to you in plain English, with the sort of language that a football club would certainly not find too difficult to understand, there has been, as you see the slide there, 300 years of global warming. As this piece of reliable empirical evidence of context proves. And I prepared this slide for Bill Clinton. Now, deforestation is a problem for dogs, as you can see there. And if you want to know where the global warming is coming from, it's actually Al Gore with his flamethrower on the top of the Greenland ice sheet. And there is a correlation, a rather interesting one, I think you'll find, between the number of sunspots on the surface of the sun and the number of Republican senators in Washington. And you'll be glad to hear that the number of sunspots on the sun is growing, and so is the number of Republican senators in Washington. It works. And of course, Al Gore says that sea level is going to rise by 20 feet almost immediately. If it did, this is what would happen to the Houses of Parliament, to which my reply is, and your problem is, global warming has a number of rather interesting benefits. Now, a horse goes into a bar, and the barman says, why the long face? Because it's a horse, you idiot. The points I'm going to be making to you today about the science and the economics and the morality and politics of global warming are all going to be points as obvious as that. Because the extraordinary thing, the extraordinary achievement of the bedwetting classes, which include your current government and your climate commission, is to have made the obvious seem absurd and the absurd seem obvious. And we're going to straighten that out again in a very straightforward, factual way. Now, why is the truth so important and why is consensus so unimportant? Well, the first thing to say about consensus is that, as you heard from Joe Nova, 2,400 years ago, Aristotle codified the dozen commonest fallacies of logic in human speech. And not the least of these is the consensus or headcount fallacy. Just because you're told a lot of people say they believe something doesn't mean that they say they believe it, still less that they do believe it, still less that even if they do believe it, it is true. Just because there's a consensus about something, it tells you absolutely nothing in reason or logic about whether it is true. And every time you hear anyone from your government or your climate commission or your ABC, every time I say ABC, I want to hear the right reaction. Now, come on. That's it. Every time you hear them say that there is a consensus and therefore we must salute and obey and believe, then you know that you're not listening to science, but political prejudice. So, let's look at some of the consensuses that have happened in the 20th century. First of all, a picture here of the Versailles Conference to decide what to do about Germany in 1918. And everyone was agreed that Germany should be made to pay through the nose for having lost the war. Result, the Second World War grew out of the First World War because the reparations imposed on Germany were so savage that Hitler was given an excuse and almost an incentive to go to war again. So consensus kills. That's the first thing we learn about it. And then, of course, there was the eugenics consensus. Almost throughout the civilized world, if you can call it civilized, in the 1920s, it was the belief among scientists and among politicians and among the chattering classes, the usual suspects, exactly the kind of people that are now saying, "Ooh, global warming." These people, they were all agreed among themselves that breeding humans like racehorses would improve the stock. Well, this nasty idea, taken up with alacrity by Hitler and Heydrich, led directly to the dismal railway yards of Oświęcim that you see here and Triplik. 6 million died of consensus. And then, oh yes, peace in our time. I have here a piece of paper. That's what he said. He was right about the piece of paper. But he wasn't right about peace in our time. The policy of the preemptive cringe, or appeasement, as it was called, was universally held. Of the 450 members of Parliament, only 21 disagreed with him. Churchill was one and a group of 20 around him. The rest of them, consensus, 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 appease, appease, appease. Jaw, jaw is better than war, war. Let not annoy the strutting masters of the universe of the Third Reich. Maybe they'll go to another universe and leave us all alone. That was the consensus. Near universal. Every newspaper, even the BBC, well, the BBC, of course, always gets it wrong. And so does the ABC. You're working well with me here. Thank you. In the 1940s and 50s, the Lysenko consensus. Trofim Denisovich Lysenko. Now, you won't have heard of this guy. He was one of the most influential figures of the 20th century because he directly killed 20 million people. He did it by accident because he was a peasant agronomist who had an idea and happened to mention it to the local Communist Party secretary that if you took seed corn and soaked it in water over the winter rather than planting it out in the cold ground to get used to the weather in Russia, then by the spring it would germinate more efficiently. There was no scientific basis for this, but the party secretary, recognizing a public relations coup when he saw one, said, "Comrade Trofim, you have made a fundamental and useful contribution to Russian climate science because you are living in the Soviet Union and therefore you are inspired, even without any education or qualifications of any kind, to make this contribution." And he passed him up the line to the regional party secretary, who made the same ridiculous speech, consensus all the way. And he went up to the general secretary of the Central Committee of the Communist Party itself in the Kremlin. And within a year or two, kid you not, this man, this peasant, ignorant clot actually is the best description for him, was made president of the Soviet Academy of Sciences. And for 20 years, they applied his ludicrous policy, and for 20 years they had failed harvests, and a million people a year starved as a direct result. And only after 20 million had died did the consensus suddenly melt away. What about the DDT consensus? You've already heard about it. It's 30 or 40 million killed. And it was only on the 15th of September 2006 that Dr. Arata Kochi of the World Health Organization, who is in charge of the malaria program, said, quite often in this field, politics comes first and science second. We will now take a stand on the science and the data. And he lifted that ban on DDT and recommended it once again as the front line of defense against the malaria mosquito, which was still at that time killing a million people a year, nearly all of them children. And so in how many countries have they lifted the ban? Very, very few. I certainly couldn't get DDT in the UK when I asked for it the other day before I went to Indonesia, malaria country. "Oh no," said the doctor, "it's been banned." "No, I haven't. No, it isn't," I said, "it's been unbanned." He said, "No, I am on the left. I know that it's been banned and it can never be unbanned." He didn't care about the science. He didn't care about how many people his policy was killing. He didn't care the policy had been reversed by an official body. No, the consensus could not be wrong, and for him it stayed banned, as it does throughout the United Kingdom. And nearly a million people every year, nearly all of them children, continue to die because consensus, consensus, consensus kills and kills and kills. And then there's the HIV consensus. 33 million dead so far, 33 million infected and again today. And why? Because instead of following the policy of identifying and isolating immediately all carriers of a new fatal incurable infection so that other people didn't get it, it's a pretty elementary policy, and it worked with smallpox. With AIDS, oh no, we mustn't discriminate against people who've got AIDS, because it's so much more fun to discriminate against all the people who haven't. And here is one of them. This lady got HIV, her two previous sons died of it, her son here, visibly sick, died of it a week later than this photograph, and she died a year after that. That is what happens to individual people if we carelessly say consensus, consensus, consensus. They die and die and die. And when they're dead, they have no voice. But let us, nevertheless, be as kind as we can. And let's make the same concessions to consensus as both David and Joe have already made. There are various questions on the screen here. Is there a greenhouse effect? Does CO2 contribute to it? Are we adding CO2 to the atmosphere? Does that mean warming will result? Are we causing some warming? To all these questions, we concede, concedo, as we would have said in medieval disputation. We agree with the other side. And on these points, the science is settled, not because there is a consensus, but because measurements have been done. Measurements which you can replicate and reproduce and check for yourselves. So we know these things to be true. So when they say to error, well, there's a consensus among 97% of scientists, they're right in so far as they're confined to the points that you see that me conceding to on the screen now. But as David has very fairly pointed out, there is no consensus about the one question that really matters in the debate about the science of climate. And that is, how much warming are we going to get if by the end of this century we roughly double the amount of carbon dioxide that is now in the atmosphere? Now, what the UN does, as you've seen, is to produce some very extreme predictions. And it does so using zitting teenagers, picking their noses, flicking the bogies, eating donuts, drinking Coke, and playing with their PlayStations and Xbox 360. In other words, it's done by model. Now let's have a look at why models don't work. In science, there are some things you can prove. Many of you would have wrestled with the proof that the square on the hypotenuse equals the sum of the squares on the other two sides of a right-angled triangle. Pythagoras' theorem. Here is a complete proof without words of that theorem. I won't even explain it to you, it's so clear. And this is by Aryabhata, a 5th century Hindu mathematician. It's a darn sight simpler than Euclid's proof, which you were probably made to struggle with, which the philosopher Schopenhauer once described as a triumph of perversity. Here you have a simple, elegant, straightforward proof. And when something is proven like that, then you don't need a consensus on it. It doesn't matter how many people believe it to be true or don't believe it to be true. It is so. And that is proven. And here is my own proof of Pythagoras' theorem in a single frame, very elegant, as I think you would agree. Let's give it a round of applause. But the climate isn't like that. The climate, mathematically speaking, is chaotic. And the father of doing numerical forecasting, using computers to try to work out what's going to happen to the climate, was Edward Lorenz. In a climatological journal in 1963, he wrote the celebrated paper on deterministic non-periodic flow, you'll be tested on that later, which founded a new branch of mathematics called chaos theory. And what he said is that in view of the inevitable inaccuracy and incompleteness of weather observations, precise, very long-range weather forecasting would seem to be non-existent. It can't be done. And he proved it in 1963. So what then happens? Well, there are many chaotic objects. You may think that the oscillation of a pendulum that regulates clocks is an ordered activity, but occasionally it can become chaotic. So is the forecasting of population. So is, you'll like this one, the cricket scores exhibit mathematically chaotic tendencies. We would like to be able to predict who is going to win. You might expect that Australia would have won the Ashes, and even if she didn't win them, at least that she'd get them back. But who would have thought that England would both win the Ashes and then hold on to them next time round? Just thought I'd rub it in. Of course it is, yes, quite right. Somebody's got to show you Aussies who's boss. So, here we are. Even the simplest chaotic equation, and I'm sure I need not explain this one to you, is something which can produce quite a complex output. And what we're going to do is make the equation draw a picture. And each little dot or pixel on the picture, starting from top left to bottom right, will be a different value of what is known as the complex variable C, the complex parameter C, which is partly a real bit of a number and partly an imaginary bit of a number. Don't worry about that for a moment. But you can see it's actually quite a simple equation. And what you'll see is the top left and bottom right values of C are very nearly identical. They only vary in the last three or four digits of a 16-digit precision. So we're being very precise about defining the bit of the object we're going to look at. Now, you might think it'll draw a simple picture like this. You'll see a guy wearing one of these T-shirts, a Knights of Malta T-shirt, in the room today. There he is. Come on, give him a round of applause. Thank you. Knights of Malta do a very good job all over 160 countries of the world doing charitable work. So it's a great pleasure to me when I found, when I was exploring the Mandelbrot set, which this little equation codes for, just watch the screen. Because this is the picture you might think a simple equation might draw. Here is the picture it does draw. Now, isn't that pretty? Now, I didn't do that with my crayons and my colouring set. No, I wrote the speech with those. This is generated by a computer. It's generated by that equation. And even though the values of the various pixels that we started with are almost identical to one another, you still get these fundamental changes in colour and these bandings that appear, and these are known as phase transitions or bifurcations, sudden changes from what appears to be a steady state, a nice smooth bit of colour, and suddenly, kerblam, you hit a fence. And even if you make a very tiny alteration to the state of a mathematical object that exhibits chaotic characteristics, you can get very big changes happening very suddenly. And these changes are known to the climate left as tipping points. You hear them say, oh, they're going to be tipping points if we let the planet warm up. Why do they all talk like babies? I don't know. Anyway,
that's our Prime Minister.
They say they're a bit, hello. My name's Julia, and I'm here to talk to you about tipping points. Really, it's ridiculous. Because the truth is that in any chaotic object, particularly one which is influenced far more greatly by natural factors than by anything we can do, even a small natural change will cause a sudden variation in the behaviour of the object, like the Brisbane floods. Remember the Brisbane floods a few months ago? Somebody forgot to turn the right wheel on a dam upstream, and Brisbane kind of got a bit flooded, didn't it? And here's a picture of it. Now, yeah, the Greens, exactly. And here's what happens when you get a sudden bifurcation in the evolution of the chaotic climate. You get an extreme weather event. But as we've seen, you don't get any more extreme weather events if you have a big change in, let us say, temperature. Even little fluctuations here and there, even tiny perturbations in the initial value of some parameter that defines the climate object, and there are millions of parameters there, not like that simple equation we looked at, can cause these major changes. But I bet you that when this Brisbane flood happened, you heard people say, well, of course, we can't attribute an individual climate event to global warming. But nevertheless, this is the sort of thing that we might be led to expect if global warming were to exist. You've heard them say that, haven't you? You've heard Julia Gillard say, well, I think we're going to get more global warming, we're going to see more of this kind of thing. Well, I do apologise for my stage Australian accent. Of course, I come from Wales myself, but anyway, this is the problem. This is the kind of wittering nonsense that they say. But of course, when we look at this picture, we are actually looking at 1893. That was the Brisbane flood of 1893. I went back through the files and got a picture for you. Don't you think? It's very interesting. And so that led to the question, how often have these major floods, as defined by your Bureau of Meteorology, how often have they occurred? And so I thought I would have a look and get the data. This is how we climate skeptics do things. We get the data. We don't just wave our arms and say, oh, it's going to be terrible, or oh, it's not going to be terrible. We get the data, we find out whether it's going to be getting terrible or not. Here we go. And between 1840 and 1900, there were 8 major floods of the Brisbane River. Between 1900 and 2011, a period nearly 3 times as long, there were only 3 major floods. So once again, you can see that there's no basis for assuming that just because we get more warmer weather, which we will if we add carbon dioxide to the atmosphere, therefore this is going to lead to more disasters or tipping points or extreme weather events. The only extreme weather events that's likely to become more frequent are warmer weather events. Heat waves, you will get more of those as the climate warms. But that, frankly, is about it, as we'll see. So to conclude on the business of whether computers can model the climate for 100 years ahead, here is my summary of the position, the long-term prediction of future climate states by using computer models is not possible. And I know that must be true because that was actually said by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change in 2001. So how then should we do science if we don't do it by consensus and we don't do it by letting loose the zitty teenagers with their Xbox 360s and PlayStations to do modelling? What do? Well, we use a technique known as the scientific method. And you won't hear very much about this in the climate debate because the other side don't use it. But we do. And here is how it worked. It was first propounded by this gentleman you see on an Iraqi banknote. He was Abu Ali ibn al-Hassan ibn al-Husayn ibn al-Husayn ibn al-Haytham. And he was even prouder, as you can tell by that string of patronymics, of his ancestry than I am of mine. He was an aristocrat, of course, all the best scientists are. He was a mathematician, a philosopher of science, an astronomer, and a thinker. Very like me in so many respects. And what he said is this, that the seeker after truth, that was his beautiful phrase for a scientist, the seeker after truth does not put his faith in any mere consensus, however broad, however venerable. Instead, he subjects what he has learnt of it to his own hard-won scientific knowledge and to scrutiny, inspection, investigation, checking, checking, and checking again. The road to the truth, said Al-Haytham, is long and hard, but that is the road we must follow. There aren't any easy answers in proper, true science. And you certainly can't just say, oh, 97% of all scientists say we've got a problem, say we've got a problem. No, we have got a problem if 97% of all scientists are saying the same thing when most of them aren't qualified to say anything about it because they've never looked. That's not a useful scientific arrangement. Consensus has no place in the scientific method. And it was put still more bluntly by T.E. Huxley in his famous debate over evolution with Bishop Soby Sam Wilberforce at the Oxford Museum of Natural History in 1860. And he said, the improver of natural knowledge absolutely refuses to acknowledge authority as such. For him, skepticism is the very highest of duties. Blind faith, the one unpardonable sin. Karl Popper, who formalized the scientific method for our time in a celebrated paper of 1934, a great philosopher, he said that, that the scientific method is an iterative algorithm. Well, now that may sound a bit complicated. What it means is it's a series of stages, each leading to the next, which goes round and round and round until a conclusion is reached. And we start in science with a general problem. And that general problem might be, well, the planet is getting a little bit warmer. Whose fault is it? We'd like to know. And then a scientist comes along and makes a tentative theory, TT, on the slide there, to explain the answer to the problem. And then, when he has put forward his tentative theory in proper mathematical terms in a scientific journal, then along comes all the other scientists and a few tiresome, curmudgeonly people like me up around the edge, and they say, right, we're going to tear your tentative theory apart. And if the theory at that point is disproven, it's NP, not proved, it's disproved, then it fails at that point, and that's where the process comes to an end. Or it may, in very, very rare cases, be proven. That's P on the other side there. In which case, the algorithm also comes to an end, and we have an answer to the general problem. And that's no more a problem. We've advanced science in a very definitive way, either by proof or disproof. But what nearly always happens in almost every scientific question is that it doesn't behave like Pythagoras' theorem. There is no easy proof or even a difficult proof, or disproof for that matter. You merely find that the hypothesis that's put forward is not disproved, it's not proved, but nobody's quite knocked it out of court. So it sort of lives to fight another day, leading to a modification of the original general problem we started with, and then the algorithm goes all round the houses again. That's how climate science should be done, in a series of disciplined, rational, organised, scientific steps. It's not what happens in real life, as we shall see. Because what we're going to do now is we're going to check the climate consensus. We're not going to do what the ABC does. What we're going to do is we're going to ask some questions. We're not going to say, oh, we just believe the consensus. Oh, yes, yes, please, can we have another grant? No. What we do is we check. So let's start by looking at a published scientific paper showing an alarming increase, as I think you'll agree, in Category 3, 4 and 5 Atlantic hurricanes from 1970 until the present. This was published in 2006. Oh, it's very frightening. And what did the paper say? Well, of course, it's all because of global warming. Well, no, it isn't. Watch. All we have to do is put in the data, which he somehow felt expedient to leave out, going back to the 1940s, and we see there's absolutely nothing unusual at all about recent hurricane trends, and we'll see a bit more about hurricane trends later on. And then, of course, we have Al Baby, Al Gore, I believe it is appropriate to have an over-representation of factual presentations on how dangerous it is. Now, first of all, anyone who talks like that, nobody should believe him for a moment. And what he's doing, in boiling it down, he's saying, I'm going to lie and lie and lie. Do you understand what I'm saying here? Good. Because I don't. Anyway, so here we have the publicity poster for Al Gore's mawkish sci-fi comedy horror movie. And this extraordinary poster appears to show the temperature rocketing up in the 20th century. Ooh, golly gosh, we're all doomed. Now then, is there anything anybody notices which is just a little bit wrong with that graph? Yes, time, Al Baby, cannot run backwards. This line was not drawn by any scientist nor any computer. It was drawn, like most of the rest of that movie, as you've heard from our gallant chairman tonight, by a public relations agent. It has nothing to do with science. And indeed, of Gore's imminent 20-foot sea level rise, the judge in the High Court case, which you've also heard our chairman speak about, where 9 serious errors in that movie were identified, said this, and I shall try and deliver it in that custard-filled voice which the High Court seems to affect. And the court said, the Armageddon scenario that he depicts is not based on any scientific view. Scientific view. That was what the judge said. And he had heard 3 days of detailed scientific argument on both sides of the case. And it was the last time the climate left ever went into a genuine legal action against people who didn't believe what they were saying. There have been many sweetheart actions, Massachusetts v. EPA for the listing of polar bears, where both sides wanted the same result, and the Supreme Court saluted and rubber-stamped it. Those sweetheart actions are a very characteristic thing among the left. The court should have refused to entertain any such case, but no, it nodded it all through. The polar bears were listed as threatened. We'll see more about them in a moment. But first, a little bit more about that sea level point. Because Al Gore says in his movie that because of the melting of 2 ice sheets, Greenland and the West Antarctic, sea level is going to rise by 20 feet imminently. But in fact, the IPCC says that because of those 2 ice sheets, the amount of contribution to sea level rise will be over the whole of the next 100 years, 6 centimetres, 2.5 inches, not 610 centimetres, which is 20 feet. So there is a 100-fold exaggeration by Al Gore. I'm going to do this big, big. So then, did he believe his own ludicrous projection. Well, no, of course it didn't. Here is a map showing at point A the $4 million condo that Al Gore bought in 2005, the very year he was making that movie. And you see the tower there, it's a real swank tower in which he bought this condo. And its address is Fisherman's Wharf. Two words which might have given him a clue that this building was really quite close to the allegedly rising ocean. He plainly didn't believe his own forecast, but he did believe his capacity to get monstrously rich by it. Please, sir, where's the chairman? Can I change sides? It's so much better paid. Well, here are the polar bears we mentioned earlier, and Gore, for once, actually cites a scientific paper. He cites it wrong, of course, but he does cite it. And what he says is, a scientific study shows, for the first time, they're finding polar bears that have drowned, swimming long distances to find the ass. Swimming long distances to find the ass. And so here is the actual map from the paper. Four dead polar bears. Ooh, golly gosh, shiver, shiver. Hold the front page. And what have we got, in fact? Four dead polar bears. Did any of these polar bears, according to the paper he was quoting, die? Or because they were trying to find the ice, or I should say, find the ass? No. They died because there was a big storm with high winds and high waves, and they got swamped. Or as we scientists call it, shit happened. I also checked a little further, and I found that sea ice extent in the Beaufort Sea over the 12 years preceding Gore's movie had in fact hardly changed at all. It had gone up a little, if anything. So there's no basis at any point for Al Gore's story. It was complete fiction from start to finish. And here's a further evidence of this, because in those parts of the Arctic where the temperature on the left had got warmer, in this case red means getting warmer, which is a fairly normal use of it, and then on the right the polar bear populations increased, where it got cooler in blue, they decreased. So this appears to suggest that the polar bears quite like warmer weather. Why would that be? Because they evolved from black bears who came from the land, and they are warm-blooded creatures, just like us. If the Arctic gets warmer, they're just going to love it. They're going to have a ball. And you heard about who? Mount Kilimanjaro. There it was in 1970, and again 30 years later, with most of the ice having gone, even though the photographs were taken at more or less the same time of year. Well, once again, Al Gore takes the scare story, immediately attributes it to global warming. But the mere fact of warming doesn't tell us the cause. And the mere fact of ice melting, as we shall now see, doesn't even tell us there was any warming. You may think that if ice melts, gee, that could only happen because of warming. But what I did, because I'm old-fashioned and I check stuff, is I thought I would look up what is the record from the satellites, which can monitor this continuously and have done for the last 30 years. What is the temperature change? What's the temperature trend at the summit of Mount Kilimanjaro over the last 30 years? Here it is. As I think you will see, there is no trend to speak of. And so it wasn't any kind of warming that caused the ice to go. In fact, in that part of Africa, Central Africa, over the dozen years or so before Gore's movie, there had been regional cooling. And that regional cooling and the consequent drying of the air, compounded by imprudent post-colonial deforestation at the foot of the mountain, had caused the ice to go from its solid state to its gaseous state without going through the liquid state of being water by a process known as sublimation, which happens in very dry air. Nothing whatever to do with global warming. So once again, the moment we do a little bit of science and a little bit of checking, all these scare stories fall away. Here is a record of the ice extent at the summit of Kilimanjaro, the middle one of those three lines there. And what it shows is that most of the ice on Kilimanjaro had gone by 1936, when Hemingway wrote The Snows of Kilimanjaro, his great novel. And therefore, the warming that we might theoretically have caused since then has not much, if at all, contributed to the loss of ice on Kilimanjaro. You've already seen also that global sea ice extent hasn't changed really much in 30 years. I mean, if you had a heartbeat as regular as the cardiogram tracking the annual fluctuations in sea ice over the last 30 years, you would be regarded as a very healthy little planet. And so then there's Greenland, about which Al Gore has far too much to say. He says it's all disappearing and the ice is melting. So I checked with one of the scientists from Denmark, which owns Greenland, who monitors the ice by using satellites to make extra ice on Greenland over that period. And when I used this slide a couple of years ago in a talk in Minnesota, there was a professor of raffia work who saw this. And he said, oh no, he said, but you haven't read the subsequent paper by Johannes. Well, no, I hadn't, because it was published the same year that I gave the talk, but slightly after the date on which I gave it. So, of course, I couldn't take account of it in my... This is how doping these people are. They long to pick holes if they can. And that paper said 273 billion tons of ice has gone since my last paper from the top of Greenland into the oceans. And I thought, that's odd. Previously, we were talking of centimetres of thickness. Now, suddenly, we're talking of billions of tons of ice. Why the change in units? When a scientist is changing his units, he might be hiding something. And what do? We convert the units back to the unit he originally used, which was thickness of ice. And we found that 273 billion tons amounted to approximately 6 inches of the 2 feet that had previously accumulated, leaving 18 inches of it still there. And so even if that 6 inches had in fact been a net addition to the amount of water in the ocean, how much would sea level have risen compared with 2003? Would anyone like to give me a figure? Almost zero is the correct answer. The answer is 0.7 millimeters. Merit star over there. And here is another way that I checked this. I was so startled when I first saw Johannesson's paper sent to me by a scientist. Then I checked it. I got in touch with the Department of Defense and I said, send me photographs of your early warning stations for those big bad Russian ICBMs which you had parked all along the northern scarp of Greenland on the ice. So on the left, two stations, as they were when they were in operation in the 60s, and on the right, the same two stations, much more recently, surrounded by a large amount of white stuff, and I don't think it was Al Gore's dandruff. I think it was probably snow and firn and ice. That's what I think it was. And so there is one of the reasons why, if people say, oh, but you can't listen to that guy Monckton, he's just a layman, he doesn't know any climate science. No, but I am a policy maker, and I know you should check stuff. And all I had to use to check this one was that useful and generally available instrument, the Mark I eyeball.
Are they still in use?
So then Gore says, oh, he says, it's terrible. It's absolutely terrible. He says, all the glaciers are melting worldwide. The mountain glaciers are melting. And 1 billion people depend on the water from these mountain glaciers. And if it all melts, then 1 billion people won't have any water. Well, of course they don't depend on the ice melt from the glaciers. They depend on the snow melt, which goes on top of the glaciers and covers much more of them. In fact, it covers very nearly half the northern hemisphere every winter. That's what they depend on for their water supply. And that, as this figure from the Rutgers University Snow and Ice Lab, that's just inside the building where that large CO2 tank was, that you saw earlier. There's no trend in any of the 5 winter months in snow cover throughout the last 40 years. There's been no decline, and in fact, in the winter of 2009-10, there was a record amount of snow cover, not a record low, a record high, because of global warming, of course. So then we go on to hurricanes, which I said I would come back to, and all you need to see here is this is the record over the last 30 years of the combined frequency, intensity, and duration of all the tropical cyclones, hurricanes and typhoons all around the centre of the world over the last 30 years, combined into a 12-month running sum, 24-month running sum, I should say, by my friend Professor Ryan, Dr. Ryan Maui at Florida State University. And as you will see on the right there, it's looking rather low, and it is indeed at just about its lowest level of hurricane activity since records began by satellite 30 years ago, and it may well be the lowest, in fact, in 50 years. So once again, this is what the data actually show, but this is not what you're being told by the APC. So then we have your own Great Barrier Reef. And you've all heard that the Great Barrier Reef is disintegrating and collapsing and dying, and it's all our fault. Well, no, it isn't. At least, even if it were, it certainly isn't because of any warming of the ocean surrounding the reef. Because here is your own Barrier Reef Authority's record of the temperature that is observed in the seawater around the Great Barrier Reef over the last 20 or 30 years, and what you see is pretty much no trend at all. And once again, all I do here is, when you listen to these people at the Barrier Reef Authority say, can I have another grant? It's all terrible. Can I have another grant? I'll make it all go away if you only give me another grant. I stop and I say to myself, all I need to do is check the data. And there's the data, and it's their own data. And it does not show, I put it to you, a warming sufficient to cause any damage whatsoever to the corals on the reef, some of which have been there for 550 million years. During 9/10 of which period, the seawater would probably have been 7 or 8 Celsius warmer than it is today. And there are just a few of the errors in Gore's movie, summarised by the judge. Once again, I shall be testing you on them later. So, Al Baby, I have been trying to debate you throughout the last 4 or 5 years. I sent a written challenge to your home in Tennessee, which consumes massively, about 20 times as much electricity as the average house. Your carbon footprint is very satisfactory, I will grant you that. But I have not yet had a reply to my challenge to you, Al Baby, to come and debate this issue of the climate on international television in any format and location that you may choose. But Al, I'm going to say this. I'm coming after you. You cannot hide. I'm going to get you. Now we're going to check what you have been told is the great IPCC consensus, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the body whose job it is to get the science right. And I'm going to look successively at three of their reports. And I'm going to take one key central conclusion from each of those three reports. And I'm going to report to you on how they reached that conclusion and leave it to you to decide whether the conclusion is legitimate or bogus. And we start then with the 1995 Second Assessment Report, a big 1,000-page document produced by 1,000 scientists. And they concluded, after looking at the evidence, when will an anthropogenic, a man-made effect on climate change be identified? It's not surprising that the best answer to this question is, we do not know. They were being honest. But you may be a little puzzled. You might not remember seeing that published anywhere in the ABC. So, and here's why not. It actually isn't the fault of the ABC. It is, in fact, the fault of the IPCC. This is going to be good. And the reason why is that this and four other statements like it were cut out from the scientist's final draft after it had been submitted. Cut out by one scientist brought in by the IPCC bureaucracy, because they said to themselves, hey, how can we go on travelling to Bali and other fancy places like this every few months for an earnest conference on the climate if there isn't any problem with the climate? One or two countries are kind of going, that guy Monckton, he'll give us a terrible time. So what they do instead is they rewrite the scientist's report, getting one scientist to do it. So here we don't know whether we're ever going to know whether there's a human effect on the climate. That's what the science said. Here is what they published. The body of evidence now points to a discernible human influence on global climate. No, it doesn't. No, it didn't. They simply changed it because they wanted one man's opinion, which happened to suit them, to prevail over the opinions of the scientists who had drafted and submitted their final report. And so this is what appeared. And I think that's an outrage, ladies and gentlemen. I think it is a disgrace that science should thus be rewritten, and that then they should dare to tell us that a consensus of 97% of scientists agrees with them, when, as we now know by researching that fact, it is actually just one man. It's an outrage. So let's move on to the next of the three reports. This is the 2001 report, the third assessment report. And here, you'll know about this, but I'm going to show you how they did it. In the 1990 first assessment report, they had shown that the medieval warm period, that camel's hump back there, was quite a bit warmer than the current warm period on the right, with the little ice age where the sun became very inactive in between the two. That's a reproduction of the schematic from the first assessment report. And as you can see, once again, this was not really what the bureaucrats wanted, because what it was saying is, well, we've got some warm weather, but it's nothing like as warm as it was 1,000 years ago. So then Ken Overbeck, one of the IPCC scientists, actually wrote to Professor David Deming, who had just had a paper on how you measure temperatures before instruments came along, published in Science, this was in 1995 by the stage. And he said to Deming, not realizing he wasn't part of the plot, we have to get rid of the medieval warm period. Not we have to check whether there was one, or check how big it was. We have to get rid of it. That's what they're doing. They're rewriting the science. And so if you just wait 11 years, watch the screen, this was their revised graph. Suddenly, a huge uptick in temperatures in the 20th century, actually exaggerating by 50%. The real amount of warming over the period, and also they've removed the medieval warm period. All gone, just like that. Magic. Here's how. They reconstructed the pre-thermometer temperature record by using tree ring data. They would cut down trees, they'd have a look at, they'd count the rings, and they'd see which ones were thicker. And they would say the thicker ones meant warmer weather. But the IPCC itself had said, don't do it that way, because thicker tree rings, wider tree rings, can also mean wetter weather, and it can also mean there's more CO2 in the atmosphere. So you will get a distorted result, which will tend to show the 20th century as being exceptionally warm. If you use tree rings, they are an unsuitable data source. And thing number one, they use an unsuitable data source. Then, for each tree ring set that they used, if the tree ring set gave them a nice hockey stick shape with a long shaft that where there's no increase in temperature or no decrease either much over the last 1,000 years, and then suddenly the blade of the hockey stick is this sharp uptick that happens in the 20th century, they would give such records 390 times more weighting in their model than they would the ones like the one on the bottom, which show no such helpful change. So they selected the data to bend the result. One of the earliest and cheesiest statistical techniques. But that's not all. That's two things wrong so far. What they also did was the computer program that processed all this data was trained in such a way that even if you put random red noise, which is a kind of random data, got nothing to do with anything, into that model, it would draw exactly the same hockey stick shape as if you put in their own tree ring data. But even that wasn't enough to wipe out the medieval warm period. They used bogus data. They used it in such a way that those of the bogus data that suited them better than those that didn't were given 390 times as much weighting. They fed them through an algorithm that was going to give them a hockey stick shape, abolishing the warm period and exaggerating the 20th century anyway. They also found that after all that, the little faint grey line that you just see on the left of this slide, it's not very clear, that was the line that the actual use of their data produced, even using their bent model. So what they did without saying so, in the paper in Nature that eventually went into the IPCC's third assessment report, was that they simply left out their own data for each of those tree rings for the medieval warm period and substituted random numbers of their own that gave them the abolition of the warm period that they desired. And so when you put back the real numbers, as two Canadian researchers did in 2005, then you get the black line and you see MWP, the medieval warm period, immediately reappears using their model and using their data, but not using the bogus data that they had invented. That is the length to which these people have gone to bend the graphs, bend the data, bend the science, artificially to create the supposed climate problem of today, which is in fact even less bad than the medieval warm period, which, as David showed you, is real, is global, and is warmer than the present. So then we'll take one more IPCC document. This is the most recent of the four, the fourth assessment report, 2007. And their central conclusion was that the rate of global warming is itself accelerating and we are to blame. And they said this three times. Now we're going to see, once again, we're going to check whether they're right. And for this we're going to set sail on a voyage of mathematical discovery known as a heuristic. Don't worry, I'm your captain. Fasten your seatbelts, fold up your tray tables, and we'll set sail. Very short little voyage of mathematical discovery. Here is a sine wave. You will have seen these at school. The important thing to know about a sine wave is that I propagate one from left to right ad infinitum. It will just go up and down like this, up and down like this, all the way. It will never deviate from essentially a horizontal line. The trend of a sine wave, as we Boffins call it, is zero. It neither goes up nor down. It just continues on forever in the same direction, either side of that central line. However, if we take just one segment, one little piece of that sine wave, and we take the trend of that, as we do now, starting from the extreme left-hand end and going all the way to the right, then there is, in fact, apparently, a slight downtrend. If we start still further to the right, choosing our starting point very carefully, it makes it look as though we've got a still steeper downslope. These are correctly calculated least squares linear regression trends. That's a way of getting a straight line trend out of data that goes up and down. And now we do it still further to the right and still further to the right. And what appears to be happening is an acceleration in the rate of decline in the direction of this sine wave, even though we know by definition that this can't actually be happening. So we know from this that it's a bogus technique. And we can show how bogus it is by shifting our segment just half a cycle to the right. And then we get precisely the opposite. Now we've got it appearing to accelerate ever more rapidly upwards. Now you may say, what has this got to do with the climate and IPCAC's fourth assessment report? Well, the answer is in the picture you're now going to see on the screen. Hold on to your hats, we're returning from our voyage of mathematical discovery. We've learned that this is a bogus technique. Now watch. Isn't that amazing? They've even used the same colour as I did. And what we've got here is the graph from the Hadley Centre of temperature change over the last 155 years, then it was 161 years now. And they've quite correctly shown in the red line there the long-term trend in the data. It is upwards, but not very fast, about 0.4 Celsius per century. So it is an uptrend. We have got warming. In fact, we've had 300 years of global warming, as those knickers on the line proved earlier. But here we've got a suggestion, which is stated explicitly three times in the report, where they use this graph three times, big and in full colour, that the rate of warming is itself accelerating. And the only reason they state that conclusion is that they take the ratio between the different trend lines shown here, and they say, this is all our fault. Well, that is an entirely bogus technique, and it is therefore an entirely bogus result. And again, it's an outrage that an intergovernmental body charged with getting this stuff right should not only get this wrong, but then when I approach first Dr. Pachauri and then Dr. Manning, two of the senior scientists in charge of all this, and I say, you've got this wrong, neither of them can tell me it's right, but neither of them will lift a finger to admit they got it this badly wrong, because this is their central conclusion. If they were to admit that this is as wrong as it is, they would have to admit there's no basis for the conclusions that they draw about what we have to do to save the planet. That is how seriously, and yet how crudely, we are being misled. And here, I thought, let me just check. No scientist, not even these knaves who are making up all this global warming nonsense, could possibly have done that. So I went back to the scientists' final report, as submitted by the 2,500 scientists who worked on that report. And that is the graph that they submitted, correctly showing just one trend line covering the whole period, no conclusion drawn about any acceleration in the rate of global warming. So once again, the bureaucrats got at it, tampered with it. Goodness knows who did the tampering. I haven't found out yet. I will, because the police are going to be called in on this one. It's so obviously fraudulent. And we're going to find out who did it. And we're going to stop it. Because frankly, what is going on here? Somebody yelled out the word fraud early, and they were right to do so. Because these people are making fortunes at your expense and mine by this bogus science. And let's do their own technique on their own data. And let's show their own trend line for the last 100 years, which I've put in green this time. And then I've added my own trend line from 1905 to 1945, and that is twice as steep as the trend line from 1905 to 2005. Phew, global warming is calming down. Well, of course, my conclusion is every bit as bogus as theirs. And because I can use the same data on the same graph, and the same technique, and yet produce a precisely opposite result, we know from that that the technique must be bogus. So then, what are they really trying to hide? And this is absolutely fascinating. What they're trying to hide is that the rate at which the world is warming is not exceptional at all. It's entirely within the natural variability of the climate, and there's absolutely nothing whatever to worry about. And they themselves have got a lot to worry about, because they know this. They know it's not warming as fast as their predictions would have us believe. You saw from David there the chart of Hansen's first attempt at predicting how much warming there would be, and how only about a third of what he predicted has actually come to pass. And that's roughly how it still is. And we're going to look at this in some detail, because it's very important. Now here we have the same graph we've just looked at. This time I have added three trend lines, but these are correctly added because I was asking a single simple question, which is, what is the fastest rate at which warming has occurred for more than 10 years at a time in the entire record measured by instruments? And there are three such periods, from 1975 to 2001, the most recent, the one we could have influenced, and two previous periods, neither of which we could have influenced. And yet, all three periods are at the same rate of warming. Just 0.16 Celsius per decade, the equivalent of 1.6 Celsius per century. And that's the maximum rate. So then, let's do a little bit of going back further into history. What's the oldest temperature record for a region of the planet that we have? It's the Central England temperature record. It started in 1659. And between 1695 and 1730, the rate of warming was almost 0.4 Celsius per decade for a third of a century. And that is three times the maximum rate of warming that we've seen over the last 155, 160 years. And that rapid rate of warming you're looking at now on the screen between the red and green arrows there, that rate of warming was before we had any SUVs to wreck the planet with. It was before the Industrial Revolution even began. It was a natural warming. Now you can say, oh yes, these were old thermometers, we didn't have Stevenson screens, and maybe they weren't terribly accurate, etc., etc. However, can they have been any less accurate than the temperature measurements from the ground that you've seen about in Joe's and David's presentation? They can't be any worse than that, can they? So what's going on? As David said, we're looking at perhaps a natural phenomenon causing the ups and downs in temperature that we see. And here is the plot of the weather index known as the Pacific Decadal Oscillation. It describes a system of weather patterns over the Pacific. And you can see there is a superficial correlation. It doesn't prove causation, but what we can say is this, that the ups and downs in temperature, and therefore these steep rises in temperature that you see several times in the graph, these are not caused by CO2, because the CO2 is rising a little bit each year, very steadily upwards, whereas the temperature graph is jiggling up and down. And therefore these jigglings up and down are not caused by the CO2, because absence of correlation necessarily implies absence of causation. The CO2 cannot have caused the temperature change, and the temperature change cannot have caused the CO2 change. They are independent variables, at least in this respect. There may be some underlying general upward pressure caused by the CO2. One would expect that. But these major fluctuations and rapid warmings, most of that can't be attributable to CO2, and that's how we know that it's very unlikely that most of the warming over the last 60 years was caused by us. And if we look at this mismatch here in the Arctic in particular, the CO2 curve, as you can see, very steady, going upwards all the time, and then you've got the temperature jiggling around all over the place, and you'll see it's a very bad fit. And so the CO2 change is clearly not a major impact on the temperature change, certainly in the very short term. But now, if we look at the solar changes compared with the temperature change, well, that begins to fit quite well. And so it means at least there is a possibility of causation between those two. Not proven, but it's at least a possibility. And indeed, we can go back to Japan, where for 100 years they've been keeping pyranometers, which simply measure how much sunlight is hitting the ground. If clouds get in the way, they'll read less. If there are no clouds, they'll read more. If the sun is very strong, they'll read more. If it's weak, they'll read less. And here again, you see a rather spectacular correlation between these very accurately kept records over the last 100 years and changes in temperature. And once again, not much room for CO2 to be the major factor in all this. And there is the record of the sun's activity from NASA over the last 300 or 400 years. You'll see that back in the Maunder minimum, what are we saying here? 1 hour. You know, I've got another hour to go. Back in the Maunder minimum here, there was virtually no sunspot activity at all, and so the planet was very cool. That was where the little ice age happened, because the sun was not so active. Then it grew to a grand maximum, where the sun was more active over a 70-year period, either side of 1960, more active than at almost any time in the whole of the last 11,400 years. So you would expect to find 300 years of global warming between that grand minimum and that grand maximum. And that's precisely what we do find. And here is the temperature trend over the last 10 years. And Professor Garnaut says of this, he says people like Monckton shouldn't produce this. They shouldn't show you this. That there's been no trend, no growth in temperature, no global warming for 10 years. He says, that's a very puzzling thing for them to say. And I have checked with econometricians, and they have said that this is still consistent with a warming trend. Well, yes, of course it is, as we'll now see. Of course, the other side, the ClimateGate emailers are saying, there has been no global warming for a decade. We cannot explain why. It's a travesty that we can't. Well, hey, they're quite right there. It is a travesty that we can't. The reason why is that natural factors overwhelm the CO2 factor. Get used to it. So, let's have a look at what is being done by your own record keeping. And here we find the actual record in blue of the temperature changes at Darwin Airport over the last 100 years. And then the red line is what was submitted by your Bureau of Meteorology for the compilation of the International Temperature Dataset. I think you will see why it is that we are not terribly happy with the International Temperature Dataset. And indeed, they've tried to suggest that the warming that's been going on since 1941 at Darwin Airport is the equivalent of 6 Celsius per century. What planet are they living on? It certainly isn't this one. Or to put it another way, what are they on? I want some too. So here is the that rapid rate of warming from 1979 to 2001. 0.16 Celsius per decade. Then we put in no warming for 10 years, then we join up the vector diagram, and we see 0.14 Celsius per decade of warming. So yes, there's still a warming trend if you go back to 1976, but it's less than it was before because we've had 10 years without any warming. You don't need to be an econometrician to work that one out, Ross baby. And let's go and look right back to 1950. There's been virtually no warming, really, to speak of, that we'd worry about since 1950. 0.12 Celsius per decade. And what does the IPCC predict is suddenly going to happen from now on for the next nine decades? 0.38, more than three times as much warming per decade as we've seen in the last six decades. There is absolutely no physical basis for any such suggestion. And the Australian government's credibility gap is even greater, because they estimate, as their central case, that there'll be 50% more warming than the IPCC does. That's the only way they can even attempt to justify the ludicrous policies they're following. So what is the maximum amount of CO2 that we could, maximum amount of temperature increase that we could prevent if we stopped emitting any CO2 worldwide today? Answer, 1.7 Celsius. That is all. They don't tell you that, though, do they? Because it would show you how remarkably stupid everything that's going on now is. And that's a worldwide figure. If we close the whole world down, 1.7 Celsius cooler by the end of the century, even if their figures for how much warming you might get are right, which they're not. So let's look at a few peer-reviewed papers that illustrate the other side of the case. And I make no apology for going on a little bit long. Would you like me to cut this short?
Yes!
I'll take that as a yes. So I'm going to carry on. So what we've got here is Professor Linton, whose picture you saw earlier, the greatest climate scientist of our age, profoundly knowledgeable about the atmosphere and how it behaves. And he thought of a brilliantly simple experiment. Because what the debate is really all about is what is the rate of change in the net balance of radiation at the top of the atmosphere compared with rates of change of temperature down here. And so he got 11 computer models, all the city teenagers lined up in a row. These are the models used by the IPCC itself. And he found that they all predicted that as temperature gets warmer, those little boxes in red there going from left to right, so the amount of radiation escaping to space actually falls. It's against the laws of thermodynamics, but that is what those models are all told and tuned to predict. Now, what I want you to do is to watch the actual record of what happens when we use the Irby and Ceres satellites actually to measure how much radiation is coming off, and we compare that with changes in the rate of temperature of the sea surface, where it's not distorted by all these idiotic sighting of the land thermometers. Now, watch the centre of the screen. It looks rather different, doesn't it? And what we're looking at there for a doubling of CO2 is not the 3.3 Celsius predicted by IPCA, but just 0.7 Celsius, a result agreed with by Spencer and Braswell in a paper published just last year. Dr. Spencer runs the satellites that Professor Linzer was using there, and he and his mathematical colleague, Braswell, have identified, they think, and been able to measure for the first time one of these temperature feedbacks that IPCAC thought was multiplying by three the amount of warming you would originally get from adding CO2 to the atmosphere. And he has found that this feedback, the cloud feedback, is as strongly negative, damping down and reducing the original warming, as IPCAC had thought it was, strongly positive, amplifying the warming. Once again, the conclusion, 0.5 to 0.7 Celsius for a doubling of CO2 somewhere around the end of this century. Nothing to worry about there. These are peer-reviewed results by credible scientists. Here is an inadvertent confirmation of this by Vents et al. In 2007. And the important thing about this is that Vents is one of the people who are in the conspiracy. He's one of the people who are fostering this whole scare. But his paper shows that evaporation from the Earth's surface happens at three times the rate predicted by the models. And that means that the rate of warming that you would expect to occur in response to any given forcing of the climate, such as adding CO2, is one-third of what the IPCC thinks it is. And here again is the hot spot. The only thing I'm going to talk about here is how much of a temperature change from a doubling of CO2 we would expect in the absence of the predicted hot spot. And once again, it's only 1 Celsius compared with 3.25. So there are 4 results. I could go on all night with different results of this kind in the peer-reviewed literature saying the same thing. So if anyone dares to tell you that there's a consensus that we're going to get lots of global warming as a result of doubling CO2, no, we're not. And all of these papers are doing it by measurement and observation and not by Xbox 360. So, we summarise the results there, and you can see the enormous discrepancy between the 3.25 Celsius predicted by the IPCC and the roughly 1/4 of that, which is more likely to happen if we believe the actual data and measurements. So how much warming will the ETS and the carbon tax prevent? Wouldn't you like to know, boys and girls? Well, here goes. First of all, we need to know how much of total carbon emissions worldwide would not happen if Professor Garnaut got his way and the scheme were implemented in full. And that would be 25% reduction in your emissions over the next 10 years. I don't think they'll do more than a fifth of that when the announcement is made on Sunday, but let's pretend. And that's only 1.2% in total of global emissions, is the Australian emissions. So that means that even if Garnaut got his way, we would be reducing global emissions over the next 10 years by an impressive 0.3%. That in turn would reduce what would otherwise have been the CO2 concentration from 412 to 411.934 parts per million by volume. Oh yes, this is big stuff here. And that in turn would reduce global temperatures by 0.00036 Celsius. That is all. But the cost, oh yes, the cost. 11.5 billion for carbon trading, 2.5 billion more for innovation. These are figures in Garnaut's report. Admin costs of 1.6 billion. That's in Penny Wong's last submission to the Budget Committee of your Parliament. Total of at least 15.6 billion a year, escalated not only at 3% per year for growth in GDP, but at 4% on top. That's what Garnaut recommends. And we're leaving out in this the 40% increases in electricity and gasoline bills you've already had to pay over the last few years since the Rudd and Gillard governments came in. We're going to leave those out of account altogether by being really, really generous to the other side. It's the only way to do these things in the end. But even then, your total cost of the ETS, proposed by Garnaut, will be $231 billion, I should say, by 2020. And that would work out, if you wanted to forestall 1 Celsius degree of warming, at $634 trillion. And if you were to just try to prevent the 0.23, 0.24 Celsius of warming predicted by the IPCC for the next 10 years, just to prevent that much over that next 10 years, then that would cost $21,000 over those 10 years from every man, woman, and child on the planet. Sir, I'll take your check now. And that is 21.3% of everything we make and do and sell throughout the world, throughout the next 10 years. That is how silly this carbon tax is. And I wanted to put numbers on it because otherwise it's just hand waving. I wanted you to see just how catastrophically expensive this is. So what then would be the cost of sitting back and doing nothing? And here we're going to take the Stern report because it produces the most extreme figures. And before we do it, we'll just look at what is the consensus of the economic literature. Now, of course, we don't do science by